Hey y'all, good evening. Can you hear me okay in the back there? Back row, can you hear me okay? All right, I'm glad to be back. Who was here when I was here, a decade ago? When was I here? Anyone remember? I think it was 3 years ago. I was here about 3 years ago. We were trying to figure it out earlier today. All right, so I'm going to just expound upon a few things. At the end, or towards the end, I don't know how long this is, we'll do a little question and answer time at the end. So some questions on, anything about addictions or anything about that, if I can encourage or help you with. I speak on sharing your faith. That's what my main talks are across the country and stuff. And so definitely ask me a question on witnessing to Muslims. I can give you some good advice on that because there's certain things, not just with Muslims, actually. I grew up Roman Catholic, and we were taught as Roman Catholics, don't go into anything non-Catholic, right? Any Catholics here remember? Yeah, we were taught that as kids. Well, now I know why. There was truth in that building across the street that I needed to hear, right? But it's easier to keep you in your group if you don't go over to that place, okay? So sometimes that's why just the term Baptist church can be too much for some people and do that. So one of the things I do, I ran into a Muslim guy the other day at the train station heading to the airport, and we just had a really nice chat about life, death, what happens. Gave him one of the books that I wrote, and he emailed me, and he said, man, I am loving this book, okay? Because, see, there was no pressure on him. He could just read the book, and I emailed him and said, hey, let's go to lunch, okay? When you get a break in your, he's a PhD candidate, so when you get a break in your schedule, email me and let's go to lunch, my treat, you pick the place and do that. See, one thing I've learned through the years is that's a much safer zone for lost people across a lunch table, in a restaurant, across a dinner table somewhere. That's a much safer zone for them. Sometimes we're trying to be safe. Hey, forget us, it's not about us, okay? We're trying to reach people for Christ, okay? So where do they feel safe at? Because I remember going to my first Christian event when I was in college. Someone invited me to a Fellowship of Christian Athletes event at Auburn University. And so I went. You know, someone invited me, so I went. Let me say something about you Christian folk. You're some strange people. I'm going to be honest with you, okay? You're strange folk. I mean, you're sitting up here. You got these guitars. You're singing these songs about Jesus Christ. I am sitting in the back over there. Sweating bullets. I mean, bullets of sweat coming off me, looking at my watch. When will this be over with so I can get out of here? As soon as that thing was done, I was out that door and gone. Gone. It was just too much for this little Catholic kid in college and stuff. But when two football players from Auburn sat on the end of my bed one day in the dorm room and told me about God and Jesus Christ, I listened to them. It finally hit me, they wouldn't have walked in my room unless it was important to them. I didn't think they were just checking something off a list by going to Mark's dorm room. It was sensed to me, it was important to them, this Jesus they were talking about. One guy gave me a Bible. I was 20 years old on planet Earth, and I had never owned a Bible in 20 years. Never owned one, okay? Started reading, started studying. Then the next thing you know, another guy from FCA witnessed to me, and then the manager on the basketball team. And when you're a college athlete, you tend to be a little bit more on the arrogant side, okay? And the people you tend to look down on are the managers, people like, because they weren't quite as good as you are and stuff like that, right? Well, this manager was witnessing to me about Jesus Christ and stuff, okay? And it just intrigued me. He didn't care if I was the basketball player and he was the manager, and it just made me think a lot. He just loved his God enough to tell me about it, so it kept me intrigued, and I kept thinking about it. And then at 25, I repented of my sins and got born again and saved. And I look back on my life, and I just look how God used certain people along the way. So, but sometimes you have to remember, sometimes we forget where other people are coming from. And I never want to forget where they're coming from, okay? So that's actually one of the interesting things. If you've ever gone down the road of drug or alcohol use or abuse and stuff like that, when you chat with someone who's going down the same road, you know what road they've gone on, right? Because you walked the same path into that, okay? So you can understand when they're telling you something, you know they're lying through their teeth. You know it, because you did the same lies back then when you were trying to cover up something in your life, okay? You can spot it quicker and do that. So sometimes that's the good thing if we have a past. Now, hopefully, especially some of these young ones back here, hopefully we don't have a past, right? Right? These young ladies over here and stuff like that, okay? I had a teenage boy walk up to me at some event I was doing, He said, "Mr. Cahill?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "I don't have a great testimony." I said, "Okay." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Sir," he said, "I've never drank. I've never used drugs. I don't sleep around. And I try to obey my mom and dad." He said, "I just don't have a great testimony." I said, "Okay." I said, "If we go by your logic, all right, that means then the worst testimony in the history of the world would have been who? Jesus Christ, okay? But last time I checked, that's the best testimony running, right? There is no better testimony than that, okay? Do you see how his head had already gotten flipped to think he almost had to have bad stuff in his life? No, I like the ones that you raise up that walk down the narrow roads, the holy roads. They go by Psalm 1 in their life, and they're just living and kicking for the Lord, living for God, because those are the ones that reached me 30 years ago at a college somewhere and stuff. Okay, those are my favorite testimonies now. Thank God for the goodness and grace of God, right, and the mercy of God, if we have messed up like that, okay, that he can forgive us, the beauty of it, okay, as he makes us that new creation and do that, okay. So just things I've learned along the way is dealt with a lot of people. So we'll do a little Q&A time when I'm done with the talk here and stuff and do that. So hopefully it'll be encouraging to you and do that. So let's pray as we get rolling. Father, thank you so much for this great chance to be back up here at Rochester Hills and back up in Michigan, Father God. And so I thank you so much for that. Father God, thank you for forgiveness. Thanks for mercy. Thanks for grace. Thank you so much for loving us that no matter how wicked and crazy we are, you still would come and die for us instead of just wiping us out and never even making us. Father, thanks for second chances, third chances, fourth chances. We've needed those so many times. I just been going through the Old Testament, Father, and you're just, your grace and your mercy is just slamming me. You're just so good to us. But let's not take advantage of that, Father, that we misuse that grace that you give us. But Father, if any of us in here are dealing with some of these addictions, but all of us in here will deal with people who do deal with these addictions, let it remind us to have grace with them as well and mercy with them. We know there's a spiritual battle going on in their lives. And we don't want the enemy to win, but we also don't want to walk out of their lives as Christians as well, that sometimes we're the anchor you're using for them at these points in their life to get them back to the cross and do that. So we thank you for the journey that you take us on. We really, really thank you for the destination that's coming up soon for all of us. And Father is telling a friend this week, can't wait to see you face to face. I just can't wait. And I just, wow. Wow, I just get the feeling it's coming soon for a lot of us. This place is getting crazy down here. So we thank you as we live lives to follow you and serve you and just make sure we're merciful and graceful as we do that, Father. So just we just thank you for that. And we do. And we ask it in the great name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Okay. We're going to talk about tonight just a different life, because you know if any of us have gone down those roads, we need a different life, right? Yeah, we need a different life, because life number one we were living wasn't good, right? It was going the wrong direction. It's going to send us the wrong place if we do that, okay? When we run into trouble, face-to-face with trouble, it's usually the wake-up call that we do need a different life. And it's fascinating to see that in people's lives, what it takes to wake people up. I can't tell how many men I've met that had to go bankrupt first before Jesus came second, right? Because their God was what? Yeah, it was money. And so God finally had to yank that business away from them, okay? Take it completely away from them, all right? For fun to realize you don't need that business. You need me. But we all get these wake-up calls in life, but we have trained ourselves as people when we get the wake-up call to reach over and hit the snooze button, okay? And then we just go on with life. Then all of a sudden, 10 minutes later, we get another wake-up, and then we reach over and hit it again, and we keep hitting this wake-up. And when God wants us fully and completely awake to serve him, all right? But he's gracious, so he keeps giving us the wake-ups, right, to get us, and we keep trying to tap that and get on with our life. But finally, wouldn't it just be simple if we were just awoke, okay, and fully serving God with our life, right, but living life? But remember, too, it says in the scriptures in 2 Timothy, those who live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer what? Persecution. So here's the other angle to it, right? When you finally start going for it for God, well, guess what? Now here comes Lucifer to mess with your family, right? And if I'm Lucifer and I want to mess up a family, I'm coming after your what? I'm coming after your kids. That's where I'm going. Okay, I'm coming after your kids. Because, boy, I have seen that break family. I have seen just parents distraught, okay, when something would happen to their child, okay? One of the things we deal with when we work a lot with youth is, especially I'm working on this in a new book and stuff, is just college. College. You send one kid off to college, and you get a completely different child back. Okay, completely different child. And you had no clue college campuses are set up to pull your kids away from Jesus Christ. You didn't even know it. And that's actually what they're designed for. You can name on one hand the degrees you need for the job you have after you get out of college. On one hand, probably. All the other degrees you didn't need for the job that you have. All it was 4 years away where they start deconstructing what their parents taught them. And stuff like that, and destroying what parents taught them. That's really what it is. I was at the University of Alabama. Anyone know where I went to college?
Auburn.
Okay, and so who's our biggest rival? Alabama. So I was speaking in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, and so we taught the high school kids how to share their faith in Jesus Christ, and so everyone had to witness to somebody that day before they came back to school the next day. So I went over to the University of Alabama campus because I knew 100% of those people needed Jesus Christ, right? It was very easy for me to figure that out. So I went straight to that campus. So I was walking around campus and I was talking with, I got in a talk with this one college student. And she told me, she said, sir, she was a sophomore. And she said, sir, she said, I can literally see alcohol every single night of the week if I want to. She said, sir, I didn't see alcohol once my entire life growing up. Okay. Then she looked at me and said, by the way, she said, I'm a preacher's kid. Okay. And what happened was, what dad didn't know was when they sent her off to the University of Alabama, that a literal tidal wave of sin came over and flopped right on top of her and crushed this girl. She was struggling big time. She was so struggling with that whole environment. She was not ready to roll. And daddy got a whole different girl coming home on weekends than what he sent out there to do that, okay? So you see, once you know how the enemy, what he's trying to do, right, then we're prepared and we're get more ready for battle. But you have to understand, he's coming after your kids because, boy, that's who you go after to try to mess with mom and dad. And do that as well, okay? So that's where we have to be ready for that. Looking at that different life and do that. So we're going to look at some things like what choices was I not making versus sometimes the choices we were making. What was I giving my life to? That's very important. That's a great thing to train up with your young kids. What are you giving your life to? Okay? Isn't it amazing when you look at people that would travel all the way from Boston or Seattle to where? Arizona, and spend how many thousands of dollars on plane flights, hotels, food, partying, tickets? The tickets were insane for the Super Bowl, right? You know, some of these people were dropping $3,000 to $4,000 to $5,000 for their 3 or 4 or 5 days in Arizona, okay? What are you giving your life to? Okay, yet the difference is I had a gentleman get a hold of me, Jose. He runs a ministry called Jesus Crew Ministries, and we do these little mini books, these little small books we do. And Jose said to me, hey, Mark, taking my group to Arizona, to Phoenix, to hit the streets witnessing during the Super Bowl. He said, can I get 3 cases of your booklets? So we sent him 600 of these booklets to hit on the streets. And when he went the year before, 2 years before in Dallas, he would send me these pictures of people on the sitting on curbs and stuff, just sitting there reading those booklets like that and do that, okay? Because, see, he uses that as an opportunity to let his light shine in darkness. You see, just the opposite. So what are you giving your life to? Because you're giving your life to something, right? It'll be a girl. It'll be a sport. It'll be a dollar bill. It'll be a family. It'll be a job. It'll be something you're going to give your life to. One of those has eternal value, right? Jesus Christ, and everything else won't have value unless it's done for Christ and what you do and do that, okay? So what are you giving your life to? And that's typically where a lot of people start going the wrong direction. They start giving their life to the wrong thing and doing that. And then the other thing is, you know, what's the direction of my life? But what's the end of the road? I do a lot of prison ministry work, and I was in a prison September up in Rhode Island. And you drive up to the prison in Rhode Island, and it looks like a castle when you drive up to it, okay? It's absolutely a beautiful prison. You don't really want to spend the night, but it's a gorgeous prison. I mean, just flat gorgeous. And it's all this stone and everything, and it looks like Alcatraz. Remember, you ever seen Alcatraz before and pictures of Alcatraz? Come to find out, when they quarried Alcatraz, they quarried the rock out, they actually sent it over to Rhode Island, and they built part of the prison with the rock from Alcatraz. So that's why it looks like Alcatraz. It's the same rock that they use at Alcatraz and stuff. And just beautiful prison. And so I go into this prison to speak to these men, and I'd been there before. And one thing I said to the guys, I said, when you leave prison, I'm doing a maximum security prison. So you have some guys that are murderers that will never get out. But when you leave prison, okay, if you walk out those doors and you hang out with the same people, okay, you'll get on the same road. And it will lead to the exact same destination place, right? Okay. But if you walk out those doors and you hang out with different people, you'll do different things, which will put you on a different road, which will lead you to a different what? Destination. Now, that's not chemistry. That's not, you know, calculus. That's as simple as life gets, right? But isn't it easy how we get so tricked into something like that? As simple as who we hang out with can determine the road we're going to head down and do that, okay? So that's why it's important. We're going to go through some of that tonight for you, okay? So our life didn't work out because we walked according to the course of this world, right? And that's really the answer. We're either going to walk God's way or we're going to walk the course of the world, okay? The pattern of the world. You have to make a choice which pattern, and especially as parents, how you're training your kids up to walk which pathway they're going to walk as well and do that, okay? My sister used to teach her kids when they were young. She would teach them, don't stand next to the narrow road and look at it. Get your feet up on the narrow road and walk on it. Okay? What an interesting statement my sister Jill used to teach her kids. And I never forgot her telling that, okay? Don't stand there looking at it. Oh, that's good for you. That's working. No. If it's the right answer, get your feet up on the narrow road and start walking down that path and doing it. But isn't it easier to watch other people walk the path and you walk the path as well? Okay? And one thing I distinctly remember, we were in Colorado at this one camp I was speaking at, and it's called Summit. And the kids, the Sunday of their 2 weeks there, they could climb up Pikes Peak. They could hike up Pikes Peak if they wanted to. And we had some staff go with them, and about the halfway point, they could tell which kids weren't going to make it, okay, and which kids could probably make it. Okay, so the kids that couldn't make it, what'd they do at that point? They turned them around and they walked back down the mountain, okay, and do that, okay, because they weren't ready. And then what we would do, we would drive a van up to the top of Pikes Peak, and because we knew about how long it would take them, and then we would pick up the kids who made it to the top and then drive them back down, okay? But one thing I distinctly remember, when you drop the kids off in the morning, there's this gigantic, it's called Bar Trail, and it's just gigantic. You could fit 20, 30 people across Bar Trail to start walking up Pikes Peak. When we drove up to the top, and we got to the top, and we're waiting at the top for people to come up, all of a sudden the trail, it's about yay wide, okay? Why was it smaller at the top than it was at the bottom? Say it. Because less people had made it that far, right? A lot of people had to do the turn back along the way of life, okay? But less people made it closer and closer and closer as you walked up to the top of Pikes Peak. And it was, and I'll never forget how narrow that trail was, okay? And here came one of our students, then another student walking up, okay, because they had made it to the top and do that. Man, I never forgot that. Do you know the closer you walk with Jesus Christ, there's fewer people closer to the cross? Fewer people, okay? So that's one thing you always have to remember. The closer you get to Jesus Christ, the closer you are in being bold and passionate about Christ and standing up for Jesus Christ, there's fewer people there. A lot of people, especially down south where I live at, they want to say some prayer, get their little get out of hell free card, hope it works on Judgment Day, okay, and then just go live any life they want to live and do that. Okay, that's not biblical. You'll never see it in the Bible. Okay, or it's critiqued in the Bible. It's never said it's a great way to live for Christ and do that, okay? You don't see that. And so there's fewer people there. So the closer you walk there, that's where you're going to start getting some of the critique from some of your family members, right? Hey, Mark, this happened to me. Relatives would ask my mom, hey, is Mark becoming one of those Jesus freaks? Okay. My mom said it to me one day. Mark, one of the aunts wants to know, are you becoming one of those Jesus freaks? I said, tell her, yeah. Okay. That's what I said to my mom. I'm like, okay, what's the big deal? Okay. So what? Isn't that better than being a Detroit Tiger freak or a Detroit Lion freak or an Atlanta Falcon freak? What's so wrong with that? Okay. But now that I've gotten older and longer in my walk, I just understand that was Satan playing games, trying to get me off the hunt and on the narrow road because I was going somewhere, right? And when you're going somewhere, don't be surprised if people don't follow you. But that's also true for sin, isn't it? Right? You go down that road, don't be surprised looking over your shoulder and there's people following you as well, walking down there, okay? So that's a choice we have to make, the ways of the world, okay? The world's been pumping garbage into our minds for years, is that correct? Pumping garbage. So raise some hand. Pretend it's a classroom. So raise a hand up. Give me an example of the world pumping garbage into our heads. What? Where does that? Larry. Okay. Tell me something on television that you just flat out know is garbage. What is it? Okay. So just the immorality. Okay. And you know we've gotten to the point now. You don't even have to waste your time with television shows. It's the commercials now that are so immoral. I mean, how different from the days when we were growing up as kids and stuff like that. Fascinating, okay? Where's the hand? What's another way we get pumped with garbage? Okay, legalized marijuana. Boy, the governor of Colorado just came out a couple weeks ago and said if he knew all the problems that they have had since they've legalized marijuana, he would have vetoed it when it was up a year ago, okay? They had no clue all the problems they're going to have with people being arrested. It's not a DUI, it's called something else there and stuff like that. Now, another thing that people didn't even think of is all the people that are driving to Colorado to get marijuana. Okay, they then drive back through Kansas and stuff like that. The border towns on I-70 right there in Kansas, they are arresting so many people, speeding and stuff. And then all of a sudden they pull up the car and the car's just got marijuana smoke coming out of it, okay? That they've put so many people in prison. I was reading one article about a sheriff in a town right outside of the Kansas-Colorado border. He went through his entire budget of inmates and feeding inmates by like March, his yearly budget, okay? See, that was the ripple effect. But isn't that true with any sin? We don't understand the ripple effect of it, right? We're just seeing this part of it. And we don't understand the ripple that's going to happen a week from now, a month from now, then even into our kids' lives down the road as well. We don't see the ripple, but that's one of Satan's tricks as well, okay? What's another thing in the world pumping garbage into us? Okay, so follow your heart, right? So that does man just use Jeremiah 17, that the heart is what? Deceitfully wicked, and the people go, oh, just follow your heart, follow your desires. No, if your desires don't line up with the book of Psalms or something like that, you don't want to follow your heart, okay? It's like a lot of times, you know, I've worked with teenagers a lot. Mr. Cahill, I'm in love. I said, no, you're in lust, okay? You're really in lust. You're not in love, okay? Isn't that true for most young people today? Sure it is, okay? But again, I'm trying to get them to think, well, wait, what's the difference? How do I figure it out? Well, see, and I'm trying to get their wheels to spin a little bit and think it through and do that, okay? Again, I got to watch those cliches. What's another place their garbage is being pumped into? Yeah, how about video games, okay? And you got to be so careful with the young ones in video games. I'm telling you, mom and dads, I don't know if I would let them even play these video games. I don't even know if I'd have this console in your house, okay? But the problem now is you don't even need the consoles. Where are they playing the games at? On their phones and stuff, right? And I'm telling you, moms and dads, I don't even know if I would let your kids have phones, okay? And the reason is because you don't know how many teenagers I've met who struggle with pornography, okay, on their what? their phones. Yeah. And oh, moms and dads, it's just not a boy issue. It's a girl issue as well. I've had young girls struggling with pornography, not to the same levels as young men or older men. But there's something about that world of the phone and the internet you can just escape on and do that. I had a lady I was working with at a church, her son Mark. She said, "Mark, would you come over and spend some time with my son?" I said, "Sure, Miss Bayard." I said, "Why?" She said, "My son is struggling with reincarnation, okay? And I just don't know how he got into this and stuff." I said, "Okay." So I came over, we had dinner at their house, and so I'm sitting there with Mark, and Mark's got his TV on, and he's playing a video game. So I'm watching the video game, and he gets to shoot and kill somebody. The person flops over, dies. What do they do next? Pop up, and they start going on, and person dies. What happens? Gets up, goes on again. I said, "Mom, not too difficult to figure out where Mark has gotten this thought idea from, right? It was right from the video game. It was as simple as can be." I'm at another house, and a couple of boys at this house, they just really gotten deep in the video games. This is old school stuff from, like, you know, 20 years ago, whatever. And, but his son was playing this game, and it was just, it was wicked. It was evil. I looked over his shoulder and was watching him play this game, and it was evil. "Hey, what's the name of this game you're playing?" "Oh, here's the box." The box, the name of the video game is called Diablo. Okay, what's the word? Devil, okay. So is it any surprise then that the son was going that direction and doing that? Okay, this is so basic. Be careful, because the other thing is when you can escape into another world, you lose touch with reality many times and do that, okay? Do you know when you study the school shooters, 100% of the school shooters were on some sort of psychotropic drug, 100%, okay? Lithium, Ritalin, one of the drugs, 100%, okay? And for a lot of these young ones, some people get under the influence and they flip. They literally flip underneath the drug. Okay, so as much as we're worried about illegal stuff, legal stuff can be just as bad in a lot of people. Matter of fact, I was in Florida one time and staying at some place speaking, and I was walking late one night, and I saw this couple there. They were 18, 19. So I just started chit-chatting with them, witnessing to them and stuff. Really interesting folks. And the young lady told me when she was 18, her mom, the doctors in the school said she needs to be on Ritalin. Okay? Why do you always trust these people, by the way? Why do you trust these? Parents know best. It's your child. Okay? Are doctors always right? No, they're wrong numerous times. Okay? Just go study how many people die each year from properly prescribed medication. Properly prescribed medication that they're dying from, let alone times when they get a bad dose or a doctor just makes a mistake. That happens as well in surgeries and things like that. Her mom puts her on Ritalin. This girl looked at me. She said within 1 week she was getting mean. She was getting angry. She said, "I wanted to hurt people." This sweet little girl sitting there, you know, in Clearwater Beach, Florida, wherever we're at, in Panama City. And she said, I looked at mom, said, "Mom, get me off this drug right now." Okay, mom got off the drug, and she's been totally fine since then. Okay, so just think about how the world tells us one thing. And then the other thing with the school shooters, a buddy of mine gives talks around the country on video games. And he's told me, and I have to verify this, but he's told me 100% of the school shooters were also doing the violent video games. Okay, 100%. And typically they're into the first person shooter games. So they're the shooter killing people. Okay. Now it's very interesting, put all that together and then just go study Robin Williams. Okay. Robin Williams got into some depression. And when he got into some depression, he kept going to these clinics and he was getting all these drug cocktails. Oh, that's danger right there. That's danger right there. They were trying him on some new cocktails. Oh, come on, y'all. You're messing with your head on this stuff, okay? Haven't we learned already? What's the one step we need to make, Larry? What's the one step? Salvation in Jesus Christ, right? It's not, I don't need a drug cocktail tonight, okay? That's not what I'm missing, okay? Just like health reasons. I'm not missing one aspirin to be healthy, okay? I just need to eat healthy. My temple will be a whole lot better, okay, and do that stuff, okay? So it's just simple things like that. He was on these drug cocktails, and then they said, that Robin Williams, at the end of his life, completely got into the first-person shooter games. He got deep into video games, the last couple weeks especially. And then some of these people, they don't even sleep. And they don't sleep, and they get in deep in the games. They don't want to get out because they're playing games of people across the world, actually in competitions against across the world. And then when you don't sleep and you get tired, don't we make horrible decisions when we're tired? Horrible decisions when we're tired. Sometimes the best thing we can ever do is get a good night's sleep. Sometimes the best thing you can do is get a good 8, 9, 10 hours of sleep and just refresh yourself, and you just, all those funky thoughts are gone, and do that, okay? Something so basic. But the world's trying to pollute us, and we've got to fight back against that and do that, okay? Remember that God didn't design us to fit into the world. That's one simple thing to always remember. God didn't design us to fit into the world. And I always remind people, remember, you're just passing through, right? We're just passing through. Passing through to the other side. So don't act like you're going to be here for all that long. Because even if you got some age on you, about, did life go by quick? Yeah, even if you're older, it just goes by so fast, it's not even funny, okay? But we're acting like, man, we got retirement accounts, okay? We got 401ks, we got all this stuff. Like, we're going to be here all that long, okay? No, we're just passing through to the other side. And if you'll keep that at the forefront, then you remember to keep focused. That's what we're going to talk about tonight. It's being focused on what really matters versus what doesn't matter and do that, all right? So just remember that you're passing through and do that. And our minds need to be set on things above and not down here, or life is never going to work out, okay? All right, so we're going to open up this book because I heard a rumor it's good, okay? So let me see these books here. Let's hold these books up if you got them. You young folks have some Bibles back there? Are they in the pews? There's no Bibles in the pews? And do that? If you have a phone, you can pull it out. Or do you have some Bibles you can hand some of those young guys? Oh, great, okay. All right, good. We got some Bibles back there for you. And then if a couple of you men or whatever can make sure they can find the right scriptures and things like that and do that, okay? Now, before we open up the Bible, I just want to give you, I may have said this when I was here 3 years ago, I can't remember, but when I've been preaching around the country, I've been giving people two words of advice before you open up the Bible, two words of advice, okay? Be careful, okay? This is the most dangerous book in the history of the world. Okay, this book flat out changes lives. Okay, this book, people will read this book today and get saved. Okay, happens in prisons all across the country. Okay, matter of fact, people will read this book and get out of addictions just by this book right here. Okay, they don't need anything else but just this book right here. But at the same time, if you study history, this book has turned nations upside down. That's how powerful this book is. Okay, but at the same time, this is the most denigrated book in our world today, is this book right here. Okay, being mocked all the time. People putting their hand, swearing upon it, their hand upon the Bible, and getting on a witness stand and lying and doing that, okay? Or given the cursory, God bless America, after every speech by every politician, and then as soon as those three words are done, going doing whatever you want to do and do that, all right? I was speaking at Kansas State one time. When I was at Kansas State, I had 400 college students, and I asked the college students, I said, how many of you college students in your classrooms have heard anything anti-God, anti-Jesus, or anti-Bible in one of your classrooms? 400 college students, how many hands do you think went up? How many? All but three or four. Okay. Then I asked them, have you heard anything anti-Islam, anti-Muhammad, or anti-Quran in one of your classrooms? How many hands went up? It was about three or four than anything anti-Buddhism or anti-Hinduism, and no hands went up, okay? See, it's just one book, okay? This is the book that's trying to be destroyed because this book contains the words of eternal life, okay? And one guy called it the other day, I was reading an article, he called it the forbidden book, okay? Because this book is becoming forbidden, that you can't bring this book into Saudi Arabia if you decide to go there and do that stuff, okay? We were actually at one point back in the day, we were actually sneaking Bibles into China. Sneaking them into China, okay? Because we couldn't just send cases of Bibles into China back in the day, okay? Think about that for just a second. So what we found out was in certain, we brought gospel tracts in, we gave those away freely, but we just held the Bibles. We kind of held those Chinese Bibles until we found some serious people, okay? Because we didn't want the Bible to get into the wrong hand, okay, and do this. What we found out was in certain cities over there, they would actually take the Bible and rip the pages out. Rip the pages out. okay? Pass them around the town. Memorize the page. Trade it with someone else. Memorize the page. Trade it with someone else. Because they didn't have enough Bibles to go around. Now think about that for just a second. As we've got X amount of Bibles on our shelves at home, 5 devices that all have Bibles on the devices. But sometimes we don't have the hunger that people have for this book. I'd rather have 1 with hunger than 10 and no hunger with the Bible and do that. Okay, we need to have the hunger for this book. And when I have the hunger for this book and the hunger for the author of the book, be careful. He'll use you in a way you can't even imagine in the days to come and do that, okay? So we're about to open up this book, but I always remind people, when you read your Bible, how often do we read our Bibles? How often? Daily. Okay, continually in the Word of God. Daily. I have it on CD, so when I'm in my car driving to the airport this morning in Atlanta, I was listening to the Bible in my car, going there and do that, okay? Soaking my mind with the Word of God, because we're fighting the world. Isn't that what we just said? So I can sit there and listen to sports radio on the way to the train station, or I can listen to God's Word. I have a choice to make, one or the other. Okay, and that's a choice I get to make. Well, one will help me in the road of life. One isn't going to help me in the road of life. I got to decide what I'm going to do and do that, okay? But we read this daily. Some people aren't in your Bible daily. I had a professional athlete ask me one time, how often, Mark, do you read your Bible? I said, wait a minute. I said, did you eat today? He said, yeah. I said, did you drink water today? He said, yeah. I said, did you breathe today? He said, yeah. I said, well, if you eat, drink, and breathe every day, you read your Bible what? Every day. It's spiritual food. How can I be the spiritual strong man I'm supposed to be if I'm not soaking my mind with His Word and doing that, okay? So that's the trick, okay, is not to get us into the book. Because if you get into the book and hide your Word in your heart, from your head to your heart, God can use you, can't He? No, He's gonna use you. Just get that straight. He's gonna keep using you, okay? But I gotta know this book as He keeps molding and shaping into it, okay? So grab your Bible, about to open it. So be what? Be what? Be careful, because you're going to see some verses tonight that you may want to argue with me about, but again, I'll walk out the door and disappear. You're going to meet the author of the book one day, face to face, matter of fact. Okay, so if you want to argue with his words, best of luck, I tell people. Okay, I had a guy one day, I was out witnessing one day at this music festival, and this atheist, he kept pointing a finger at me. He said, I can't wait to meet God. He kept pointing his finger. He said, I got so many questions for him. I can't wait to meet God. Just kept pointing his finger, just this arrogance. And I looked at him, I said, no, you don't. He said, what? I said, no, you don't. He said, why? I said, you need to read the last, like, 5 chapters of Job if I were you. He said, why? I said, it looks like to me God asks most of the questions, okay? Do you see the end of Job there? God's asking the questions. And who's being quiet? Job is being quiet because he realized, I made a mistake here, okay? And God is speaking and he's in his proper place. See the arrogance of that man? You're not going to point your finger at God. You're going to be face down in front of God the moment you die. And if you choose to go to hell for eternity, you're going to wish you would have repented and believed while your time was down here. And you don't get a do-over and do that. But if we as Christians care about those people, I want them to, by choice, bow their knee to the Most High God. Because we love Jesus enough to go tell somebody about that and do that. Okay, all right, let's open our Bibles. Let's go to the New Testament, go to the book of Ephesians. Okay, so Ephesians. And so Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, GEPC, go everywhere preaching Christ. GEPC, so very easy way to remember those, GEPC. Go everywhere preaching Christ. Okay, so now I'm going to have so some of you to volunteer and read the scriptures for us. Let's go to Ephesians 2. And let me get a volunteer for verse 2. So Ephesians 2, verse 2. Okay, hands up, volunteer. Someone just, okay, ma'am, nice and loud. Okay, thank you. Excellent. I'll say the course of this world. So there's a pathway of this world that Satan wants you to walk down according to the prince of the power. Who's the prince of the power of the air? Okay, is Satan real, yes or no? Okay, careful. We're getting to the now where people don't even believe he's a real being, okay, or demons aren't real. That's the most foolish thing I've ever heard, but again, Satan's lying in the end of days here, so I'm not surprised by any of this, okay? The prince of the power of the air. What do people want? People want power. They want to be in control and do that, okay? Reading even certain musical artists who are admitting they have actually sold their soul to the devil. Reading an article the other day about the Super Bowl singer, okay, selling her soul to the devil. Just reading about a singer in England, she's pretty popular, and she said, to make it in this business, if you want to be top, 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 you have to sell your soul to the devil to make it there. And she's not top, 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 she's a little bit below that. And they said, well, wait a minute, you're here and you're not quite there yet. She said, I haven't sold my soul to the devil yet. She actually admitted it, okay, that they know they're turning their life over to the prince of the power of the air. Hey, but isn't that what so many people want? They want the fame, the fortune, they want to be in front of a group or a crowd and think that that's what they want to do. I tell people, you know, you never want to pray for your kids to have wealth or fame. You never want to do that as parents, okay? What you want to pray is, Heavenly Father, if my son or daughter ever gets wealthy or ever gets famous, they have the heart to deal with it. Okay, that's the danger. Okay, I can't tell you how many young people I've met, young men who've told me they're going to join a fraternity in college to change the fraternity. Okay, and about 99% of the time, where's the change take place? In the young men. They're the ones who changed. They didn't change it, okay? They got changed in the whole process, okay? Because the prince of the power of the air was very real, all right? The spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. So the people are going down the wrong roads, the drug to alcohol roads. Satan's working their lives, yes or no? Yes, the temptation's there, and they're saying yes to the temptation, okay? So whether it's you or whether it's someone you're dealing with or going to be dealing with one day, because the drug use is only going to get worse and not get better. Okay? It's only going to get worse and not get better. How do I know that to be true? Because it's getting to the point now, they're going to force you as parents to give certain medications and drugs to your kids. Okay? We can talk all we want to about vaccinations in the last week, okay? But when it gets to the point they force you to give a vaccination to your kids, if they can force one drug upon them, then they can force the next drug upon them. And then the next drug upon them, and the next one, okay? And you've read about the young girl, I'm trying to think what state it is. I want to say Oregon, but don't hold me to that. That the girl has cancer. She's 16 years, she has cancer. And she doesn't want the chemotherapy. The mother doesn't want to have the chemotherapy. And the state is forcing her to have chemotherapy for the cancer. You read this one? This is fascinating. This is one of the, to me, this is one of the biggest cases in our country right now, okay? Because when they can force you as a parent, what they're basically saying is, you're not the parent. That's what they're saying. They're saying, we as the government are the parent of your child, okay? We live in dangerous times, y'all. Dangerous times. And that's where we have got to get a backbone and our feet strong upon the Word of God and put our feet strong and not back up anymore. We've backed up enough as Christians, okay? We backed up enough. We got to be forward-thinking people, not backward-thinking people. And if I won't even stand up for a child, then when it comes to a vaccination, how are you going to stand up for the big things that come up and do that? But also, don't forget this, moms and dads. What are you teaching your kids? If they're looking at us and we just keep backing up all the time and backing up and backing up, why are we surprised when they won't raise their hand up in a classroom in a high school or college campus and make a bold stand for God and Jesus Christ? Because they saw us back up and do it. Remember, we're teaching that next, the ripple effect we talked about. The same ripple goes in a good way, right? If they see us standing strong for, we'll talk about this tomorrow night at the Beast Feast, and seeing us stand strong for Christ and us being bold and sharing our faith, don't be shocked if your kids are the exact same way and do that, okay? But they got to have that example around them to do that, because Satan's working the children of disobedience. Okay, now go to Ephesians 2. Give me three volunteers. Let's go to verses 4, 5, and 6. So some hands up, please. Volunteers for me. Verse 4. Right there. Okay, hands up for me. 5 right there, and then 6 right here. Okay, so verse 4. Boy, aren't we glad he's rich in mercy? Yeah, aren't you glad? Okay, and with the love he loved us. Okay, 5. Okay, now think about that for a second. And what it means, he made us alive. Isn't it nice to be alive in Christ? And if I'm alive in Christ in the ways of Jesus Christ, I don't want to go back to the dead ways The dead-end ways, right? The dead-end streets that we used to go on and get back on, where Satan's trying to trick us to go back down those streets again. And then verse 6.
And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
Okay, so in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So again, part of what we're trying to do tonight is keeping our minds set on the right thing. You may think you're seated in blue pews here, but you're seated with Christ once you're saved. Okay, we're just not there yet. All right, we're just passing through here to the real good seats, okay? The front row seats, okay? At the best event you'll ever go to in your life, all right? But we have a job to do here first before we get to the front row seats. Does that make sense? Okay, so what I would do if I was Satan, I would trick you to think maybe some other seat was more important, okay? Of becoming a millionaire, maybe, chasing a dollar bill. But then all you got to do is study, it was one of the Rockefellers back in the day, and the Rockefellers at one point in America, the Rockefellers owned 2% of America. So one family owned 2% of all of America. This is fascinating to think about, that someone could have that much wealth, okay? And they asked one of the Rockefellers, how much is enough money? And his response was one of the most amazing answers you'll ever hear. He said, $1 more. Because if he got the next dollar, then what would he want? The next one and the next one. Money can't satisfy you, right? Money can't satisfy you. Fame can't satisfy you. Why does Michael Jordan come out of retirement once he already retired from basketball? Why do the Rolling Stones still tour in their 70s? Do they need the money, yes or no? No, they're buku money. They got tons of money. The reason is, if you've never been in front of a crowd and had people clap for you, okay, it is the worst and biggest addiction in the history of the world. Okay, I've played college basketball, and I've played in a game one time where my best game in college, we beat the number one team in the country, University of Kentucky. Okay, I will never forget the adrenaline rush inside that gymnasium, and 12,000 people are just going off. Seriously, there's been nothing like it ever in my entire life. I can't tell you how addictive it is. Okay, I've also been there when I missed the last second shot against Alabama, our biggest rivals. So you go from hero to goat rather quickly in sports, and it's a real quick move there, so it reminds you as well. But I can't, that addiction, that's what they come back for, is to get this, because they can't get it anywhere else, the rush that happens there and do that, okay? Very fascinating to think about when you do that. But again, we got to remember what's the most important, being there with Christ. Go to Colossians chapter 3. Philippians, Colossians. Go to Colossians 3 and go to verse 2. This is one of my favorite ones. Colossians 3, volunteer, and verse 2. Okay, so it's Colossians 3, and this is just one of my, just really my favorite ones. Colossians 3, and go to verse 2, okay? All right, go for it.
Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth.
Okay, so think about that for a second. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. That's the danger. See, because I can see, touch, feel all this down here, right? But I can't see, touch, feel Jesus Christ yet. Yet, all right? And I've just been working on something recently on this new book, and part of the theme is horses and stuff. And I was just thinking about horses, and even today, thinking about horses put blinders on, don't they, in the Kentucky Derby and stuff? Because they got to get the horse what? Focused. If I can keep the horse focused, me as the rider, you as the horse, we can go win this Kentucky Derby. But if I got you looking this way and looking at that filly over there and doing all this stuff and just going everywhere, we ain't going to win the Kentucky Derby. It's not going to happen. Well, see, that's what Satan's always trying to do. Okay, we're supposed to be focused on the things above. Okay, but yet we're looking this direction, then we're looking this direction. We got to be focused people. But we do get off track, right? Yeah, we do get off track, and that's the beautiful R word, that we get to repent of that and get back on the narrow road again, right? Sure. Okay, so we stumble, we fall, Satan tricked us, we bought the trick, we bought the lie, we repent and then just get back on the road. But I got to set my, what was the word there? Affections. That goes back to what he said up there, okay? Knowing something in my head is one thing. Making it part of my heart and my life and my affections and doing that. Listen, ask your kids sometime as a parent. It can be tough. Ask your kids sometime, hey, I'm your dad, I'm your mom. What do you think I love the most in life? okay? What do you think I love the most in life? Ask some coworkers that question, okay? So get out of our own little world, okay, and ask some people what they think is your biggest affect, your biggest love in life. Because what you love the most, you can't hide. It comes out of you, okay? I actually did this with my students when I was a school teacher. And I was at this Christian high school, and one of my boys, Jimmy, was he, eighth grade? No, he's ninth grade. And so we had some big event at our church. Well, some of his buddies came. And so I said, Jimmy, if I asked your friends what's the most important thing in your life, Jimmy, what would your friends say? Oh, Mr. Cahill, they'll say Jesus Christ. No doubt about it, they'll say Jesus Christ. I said, okay. So we end up at this event, and some of his buddies are there that don't go to our school. So we're hanging, hey, Jimmy, who are your friends? Hey, great, hey, let me ask you guys a question. Jimmy, what do you think is the number one most important thing in his life? First boy, oh, baseball, man. Jimmy loves baseball. Oh, what a great baseball. Man, he can hit that ball, boom, boom. I said, okay, great. I said, what do you think? Oh, man, music. This dude loves music. He can pick up a guitar and he can play, man. This dude loves music. I look over at Jimmy. Oh, my goodness. If you could have seen Jimmy's face. See, Jimmy thought one thing, okay, but that was not what everyone else knew by watching him. It's a really good check for you, okay, to see, because we think we, like me, do you know the answer I've gotten? Because I've asked people about me. They said, sharing your faith in Jesus Christ. That's still not the right answer, right? The answer is Jesus Christ. It's not sharing your faith in Jesus Christ. But if that's what they got out of it, I still not where it's supposed to be at, okay? The thing they should know most is that dude loves Jesus Christ, okay? That's why he lives his life and exists today and do that, okay? It's a real good gut check sometimes. And it doesn't mean what they always say is true, but it's a good check on us sometimes to ask people around us. Try it with your coworkers and do that, okay? But setting your mind on things above, okay? No one wants to be on the wrong road. Think about how people joke about a careless life until tragedy or consequences strike. See, we joke about sin until the consequence shows up and do that. We were at our Christian school one day, and one of the referees from basketball came in, and he knew some of the teachers there. So we were sitting there having lunch at the teacher's table and stuff, and it was right around the Super Bowl years ago or whatever, and someone made a comment about one of the Super Bowl commercials, and the referee said, you know, he said, ever since my daughter was killed by a drunk driver, he said, I can't quite laugh at the alcohol commercials like I used to during the Super Bowl. All of us at the table were, oh my goodness. Never even thought about that. Never even thought about the people who watch the Super Bowl and were trying to have the funny little Clydesdale commercials or whatever the commercials are nowadays, okay? And yet there's people sitting there that had their daughter killed by a drunk driver. What a gut check when that man said that, okay? But see, all of a sudden when the consequence hits you, right? Now all of a sudden ain't quite as funny anymore, right? When we joke about the town drunk or something like that. Not when it hits us all of a sudden, how personal it gets and do that, okay? So think about that with sin. Sin takes you farther than you want to go, keeps you longer than you want to stay, and costs more than you want to pay. Think about that for a second. 100% chance that you won't have trouble when the door to sin stays closed. I like this statement. A 100% chance that you won't have trouble when the door to sin stays closed. That's just an interesting statement. If the door to sin is closed, I'm okay. Life is good. Okay. I was reading some stuff on vaccines this week since that seemed to be one of the big topics. And you heard of the Gardasil vaccine? This is the Gardasil. It's for HPV, which is a sexually transmitted disease. So now it's being suggested that young ladies get this Gardasil vaccination. Okay. So I did some research this week. There have been 213 women who have had permanent disability from taking the Gardasil vaccination, okay? 32 women have died, okay? I actually know of 100% way that you will never get HPV once in your entire life. What would that be? Yeah, absence, not sleeping around, okay? Not sleeping around. Wouldn't that be a better thing to teach our kids, right? To not do that? Then we don't have to even worry about the vaccination and stuff like that. But do you see how we're so deceived? But don't let that surprise you when the world wants to teach you that all we are is highly evolved animals. That when people act like animals. I mean, that shouldn't shock us and do that. But once we know we're a special creation of the Most High God, and there is nothing like us on planet Earth. Matter of fact, we are so unique and different, there is nobody like us on planet Earth. Even if you're an identical twin, there's someone different than you that looks just like you. Okay? Think about how special that makes you in the eyes of God and do that. And I do that. Matter of fact, I do that a lot with lost people. I use things like that when I say to them, because they don't think they're special. Matter of fact, people who are struggling with alcohol and drugs, they don't think they're special. They're just focused on the sin. They're focused on the addiction and forgetting, wait a minute now, there is nobody like me on planet Earth today. God had so much fun creating me. He broke the mold and decided to go make someone else and do that. But Satan's tricked this one here, tricked me, right? So I'm not remembering how God made me, okay, and did that, okay? Sometimes life needs to change. We need to make that change, okay? Remember, God gives us new life. Is that correct? Yeah, he gives us a new life. Choices open up with wisdom, and God gives wisdom for the asking. A good way to define wisdom with people, I always tell people, is wisdom, a very simple way, is biblical knowledge applied. That's wisdom. Okay? Biblical knowledge applied. That's a very simple definition of wisdom. Okay? But that assumes a couple things, just like you were talking about with Psalms 1. Biblical knowledge applies, assumes I know what? The Bible, that would be the first thing, right? I have to know the Word of God, and then I have to do what with it? Apply it. Yeah, I actually have to make an action. There has to be an action mode here, okay? Again, you can have it here, but if it's not here, it's never going to be out in my life and making a difference in my life and then rippling into other people's lives as well, okay? Go to 1 Corinthians 15. So back up a tad. Go to 1 Corinthians 15. And go to verse 33. Okay, 1 Corinthians 15, 33. Okay, volunteer for that? 1 Corinthians 15, 33. Okay?
Be not deceived, evil. Communications corrupt good manners.
Okay, evil communications corrupt good manners. A bad company corrupts good character. Be not deceived. Bad company corrupts good character and do that, okay? Be very, very careful who you hang out with and who your kids hang out with. Very careful, okay? Because typically that's what's going to pull you down the road and do that, okay? I was putting this talk together this week, and so I thought back, when was the first time I drank? The first time I drank a beer, I was in ninth grade. Okay, is there a problem already? Yeah, I'm in ninth grade, okay? I'm a ninth grader in a car with Bart Hay, who's still a friend to this day, who was in my grade but a couple years older than me, all right? Right, exactly. And we're in a car Friday, Saturday night, and he's driving, a girl with us, and then he pulls out a beer and starts drinking a beer because he was old enough to get it. Maybe. Maybe he wasn't. I don't remember now. Then the beer starts being passed in the car, right? Okay? And then all of a sudden, now you don't want to be uncool, right, when it comes to you. And I had never tasted a beer before in my life. So I was a ninth grade boy, so you're probably 15 years old, right about that age. And I thought a little bit this week, until I got saved at 25, I have no clue how many beers I drank between ninth grade and 25, but it was a lot. But it always starts with one, doesn't it? One becomes two becomes three, and then you have no clue how far that is going to take you down the road. I used to teach in all boys school and asked Jason one day, a student, he wasn't my student, but he always liked me and stuff, so I said, Jason, I said, are you drinking and driving? He said, no, Mr. Cahill, I'm not drinking and driving. I said, you're sure? He said, no. I said, well, you know, I did have one beer on Friday night. Okay, wait, Jason, I just asked you, I didn't ask if you were drunk and driving. I asked, were you drinking and driving, Jason? And he said, one beer. So, see, Hardy, it was messed in his head, right? One beer wasn't so bad, okay? Then as we kept chatting, then it, all of a sudden it worked itself up to six beers and driving a car, okay, as a teenage boy, okay? But see, you can't get to six beers until you start with what? One, and one becomes two, and two becomes three. And again, that's one of the things you really want to encourage and challenge those around you, is it's just one beer, one joint, one hit, whatever, one cigarette, whatever, that becomes two, three, four, five. So remember, too, when we repent of that, come to Christ, become new creations, and we get off that stuff, that's all behind us, right? It's under the blood of Christ, right? It's long gone, history gone, okay? Long gone. Now, Satan can't get me back again until I have what? One again. That's right, okay? Because I'm back to zero now. The slate is clean. It's long gone. He's just got to get to, he doesn't have to get me to two. He just has to get me to what? One. Here we go again, okay? So again, it's simplify it with people. Simplify it with people, okay? And I don't even want the first. And I specifically remember I played a college ball with Charles Barkley years ago, and I went out to Phoenix. I had become a Christian. And Barkley heard I had become a Christian. So I went out to Phoenix for some things. And so I went out late one night with Barkley and some of his friends. We're at some place. And so we're sitting at a big round table. And Barkley buys drinks for everybody. And he buys me a beer. And it just sits there, gets warm. I'm just talking with people. Charles buys another round for everybody. And he buys me another beer. Sits there, sits there, gets warm. I'm talking to people. And all of a sudden, I look across the table. And Charles is sitting across me at the table. And he is staring at me. He is boring holes through my eyes. Just boring holes. Because he liked the old Mark. That was the guy he liked. And so what he was trying to do was what? Yank me back into where I used to be. Well, that's my old self. It's not my current self. That's long gone stuff. Okay? Now, when we're out and about, if we're ever in a place like that, and someone offers me a drink, okay, he'll say, hey, don't get that away. He doesn't drink like that. Get that away from him. Okay? See, now he's standing up for me when the other stuff comes around, okay? Because what happens is a lot of lost people respect the position you've taken. They respect the stand you made. And they wish they could do the same thing, but until they get to Christ, okay, the step one, and no other steps are necessary, right? They can't get there and do that, okay? So once you've put your feet down and you're not going to drink and you're not going to drug, don't budge. Don't back up off your position, okay? Stay right there. I have a joyous time in life. Joyous time of life. And I don't need any chemical of any kind to enjoy life and do that. Okay? None. And it flips people out that you can actually enjoy life because you're enjoying Christ. And because you enjoy Christ, you enjoy people. I can enjoy situations in life that do that, okay, that I couldn't do before. Because actually the chemicals were stopping you from enjoying that stuff and do it. Another trick of the enemy to do that, okay? Go to Romans chapter 6. Romans 6. Okay, go to Romans 6 and go to verse 16. Romans 6, 16. Romans 6, verse 16. Okay, volunteer. Someone who hasn't volunteered yet. Give me some help, please. Okay, young guy, thank you. Okay, very good. Thank you, Ben. Okay? No matter who you yield yourself to, you're going to become a slave to whatever you yield yourself to. Okay? You're either going to be a slave to righteousness or a slave to sin, but you're going to be a slave to something and do that. Okay? There's a movement going around with the younger Christian movement in our country today, and they're trying to end slavery in other countries and stuff like that. End slavery. Okay, so they're trying to raise money and get these kids out of slavery, and then they won't be in slavery anymore, and boom, boom, boom. No. Even if you get out of slavery or prostitution, they're still a slave to sin or a slave to righteousness, one of the two. A buddy of mine runs a ministry, Dave Farmer, and Crisis Rescue International. And we give him a bunch of nickels, and what he does with the money is he goes to India and he buys children, okay? Because he went to India for something, and he turned the corner, and he went, and there was a cage there. And there was a 6, 7, 8-year-old girl in the cage, okay? And he said, what is this? He said, she's a prostitute, okay? We're waiting for someone to buy her and do this, okay? And he's a daddy, and he's got a girl. Okay. His rage got going. His fire got going inside of him. It ticked him off. Okay, he was hot. What he did was he started a couple homes in India where he actually goes, and he just did an undercover thing where he went to a hospital and he was buying kids in the hospitals because he found out that ladies were having the babies, selling them to the pimps. They'd raise the kids to 6, 7 years old, then put the girls into prostitution. Think about this, y'all. This would drive a few of us crazy. Okay, it drove Dave so crazy. He started 2 different homes over there. He's hired local Christians to run the homes. He now has, I think right now he has bought, I think it's right about 280 girls he's bought. Okay, and there's some boys there too, because brothers, sisters, he ended up getting the brothers with them. Put them into these Christian homes to get them out of prostitution, to get them to the Christian homes, trained up in the Word of God. So eventually they'll get what? Saved, right? Because either way, even if they get out of prostitution, they're still a slave to sin or to righteousness, one of the two, all right? But his anger, his righteous anger, just finally got to Dave. I mean, he just got back from India. Again, we gave him some money to buy some more girls. So money that comes in for people buying books from our ministry and stuff like that, they don't realize what the money goes to. But part of the money that comes in, we buy kids, okay? We get them out of prostitution, but we put them in a Christian home. So then get trained up like the kids who go to school here and stuff like that, right? And get that great foundation that hopefully they're going to come to Christ in turn. But think about that for a second, because you're a slave to something. I'd rather be righteousness, right, than the way it used to be in our lives and do that, okay? Go to, one last thing before we turn. Simple thing I tell people all the time. If you've opened up a door to sin in your life, okay, close it. Simple. If you've opened up a door to sin in your life, close it. Okay? If video games are your issue, take the video games, find a trash can, throw it in there. Okay? I tell young kids all the time, when they tell me their iPod or their phone is more full of secular music than Christian music, take your iPod, find the nearest trash can you can find, drop it in there, and get on with your life. Okay? That's a choice you have to make and do that. I was speaking at a Christian college, and this boy came up to me for lunch. He said, "Can I sit and eat lunch with you?" I said, "Sure." We start chit-chatting, and a really nice young man, and he's a preacher's kid, and from missionary parents, preacher's kid. He looked at me. He is so struggling with pornography and marijuana, and we're just killing this kid, destroying this kid, and he knows it too, just killing him. So we started talking, so I used this example. I used it during chapel that morning, I think it was at the college, and he looked at me. He said, "Sir, I need to take that door, shut it, and lock it." Okay? I like that. I've used it from now on. We need to take certain doors, shut them, and lock them, right? Just lock that door and don't let it be opening. Because it's not opening from the other side. Satan doesn't have the key. We turn the latch and open up the door, and then here comes all that junk again from whatever the one we're struggling with, right? Shut it and lock it. Good thing to teach your kids. Shut those doors and lock those doors, and don't reopen up the door. But if you make the mistake and reopen the door, do what? Shut it and lock it again, okay? And just lock it one more time that it can't open up back again. Go to John chapter 8. Go to John 8. And go to Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Go to John 8. And let's go to verses 6, 7, 8. Let's go to 31 and 32. So two volunteers, 31 and 32. Okay. Some people haven't got one. That's 31 there, and then we'll go 32 right back there. Okay, go for 31. Okay, one of the best parts of this, because a lot of us know 32, but if you continue in what? My word again, back to his book again, back to his scriptures, knowing these scriptures, living these scriptures, okay, speaking these scriptures, getting from our head to our hearts, wisdom, okay, just obeying the words of God, okay, applying the biblical knowledge that we learn, okay, then 32.
And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
Okay, don't we want freedom? I like freedom, okay, we all like freedom, okay, but freedom comes from knowing the what? Truth. That means if there's truth, that means there's also what? Lies, errors, okay? And so who's the father of lies? Satan. So here we are back one more time. Again, it just simplifies itself all the time here in the scriptures. There's a battle going on. There's especially battle going on in this country called America. We're the most chemical-using country in the world. Do you know that the United States of America uses, I think I was reading the other day, 50% of the world's prescription drugs are used in America? We have 5% of the world's population. We use 50% of the prescription drugs. Okay, that's fascinating to think about. Okay, because they can be just as addictive as any other drug that's out there, okay? But what it typically is, they just want the money out of your pocket, and that's one way they can get it out of your pocket, is getting you hooked on some drug from cradle to grave, right? They'll drug you all the way from Ritalin from the baby to chemo to the end, and they've made $250,000 off of us by the time we take our last breath and do that, and that's all it was. We were an ATM for a lot of pharmaceutical companies. It's really true if you think about it, an ATM. And they just kept taking money from us and money from us and money from us, okay? Now, there's times for it. I was in the hospital a year ago. Something happened to me, and I had to do some drugs when I was in the hospital. But as soon as I got out, got off those things as quick as I possibly could, started doing natural stuff for my body, stuff the Bible says to put in your body, and healing myself back up, feeling the best I felt in years and stuff like that, okay? But I had to make choices to do this, okay? Because this is the temple God gave me. But trust me, a lot of people can start off a legal drug and then go to illegal drugs from that because they like the highs that come from that and stuff like that. Another danger zone that we're being tricked at and do that. Okay, so there's truth, there's lies. I got to keep running to the truth and do that. Okay, so we want a new life. But one thing I always want to remind people is that when we're talking about God, we're not talking about a fairy tale God. Does God change our lives, yes or no? Anyone excited that you serve Christ, you're living for Christ, okay? Yeah, it's a different life. I go back to my high school reunions and my buddies always look at me at reunions like, dude, you're so different. You're so different. Because dude is different. We're supposed to be different when you serve God and Jesus Christ. Right? It should be the most evident thing in the world, okay, that we're not like anyone else who walked into Kona restaurant tonight. I went in there to eat and to stand for Jesus Christ and God and hand some books out and talk to people. I don't want to be like anyone else that's walked into that restaurant. I want to be an example of the Lord Jesus Christ walking in, walking out, whatever that means, and do that, okay? But that's that new life, that excitement we should have about that. You know, God's in the business giving us a second chance that we need to be thankful for and do that. And he can always restore the broken places in our life. But again, when we're talking with God, we're talking about he really cares about us. There's real hope, real forgiveness, real truth, real life. This isn't a fairy tale. Some people still think of God as a fairy tale or the tooth fairy or something like that or Santa Claus. This isn't the God we're talking about. This is a real God, all right, that we really commit our lives to and we're really going to meet one day. Okay, and I've got to really care about this God and then let him work through me in people's lives. Okay, let's go to Psalm 37. And so it's funny how when this was all coming together, Psalms became a big part of my talk here. And didn't know you guys love Psalms as well so much. And so go to Psalm 37. And let's go to verse 5. Psalm 37 and verse 5. Okay, volunteer for that? Okay, go for it.
Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass.
Commit thy way unto the Lord. Okay? When you commit your life unto the Lord, it can be a very narrow road. Might not have as many friends as you think you have. Friends can go by the wayside when you serve Jesus Christ. Because they might like the old mark better than the new mark. That's okay. That's okay. I can't worry if people want to fall by the wayside. I'm going this direction. If people want to come, and come on for the journey. If you don't, I can't worry about that, okay? I know what I'm doing in my life, and focused people and leaders have to be people who think like that and do that, okay? But watch, even if you have friends that fall by the wayside, Charles Barkley, I was out with dinner with some of his friends the other day, and one time Charles told me, he said, Mark Cahill, you're the best friend I have on planet Earth. That's a nice thing to hear from anybody, let alone Charles Barkley. He has not returned one phone call or one letter. We're pushing about 10 to 11 years now. Hasn't returned one. And I write him once a year, either on his birthday, which is next week, or Father's Day, I'll write him a card. And it's not always about Jesus. Sometimes it's, hey, I hope you and your wife, Maureen, are having a great year. You know, I hope your daughter, Christiana, is doing well. Just something to encourage him and stuff like that. He's returned none of it because he's walking with a different crowd, Psalm 1. Okay, I'm walking with a different crowd. Okay, but won't he also know who to pick the phone up and call when he wants to talk about this serious stuff? Of course he will. He'll know who to call. We just got an email to the ministry the other day from some guy I witnessed to in front of the Versace mansion in South Beach, Florida. And it's this crazy bar section of Miami. It's insane. But people are out to 4 or 5 in the morning. And I just walk the streets and chat with people. And I talked with this guy, and he put a Facebook thing on our Facebook thing. And he said, yeah, you gave me this book, More Than a Carpenter, boom, 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 to read. And I read it and stuff like that. Wait a minute. That would have meant that I didn't have a book of mine to give him. Typically, I would give him one of my books, right? That means my first book came out in 1999. That means I had to witness this guy in like 97 or 98. Okay, he got a hold of us 18 years later, okay, to the ministry. I actually wrote him a letter, and he said this thing, and I sent him a book in the mail, and he found it going through his stuff again. He got a hold of us. Well, now he gave me his ad. Now I'm writing him another letter, okay, and sending him one of my books this time, okay, because he has no clue what's happening in the last 18 years and, you know, serving God like that. But again, we don't walk with that, okay? When I'm committed to Christ, I'm out there trying to reach people in front of the Versace mansion. You had a guy shot and killed right there. And people are standing there taking pictures of the mansion and stuff. You don't think you can get in a conversation about life and death standing right on the spot where someone was shot and killed and do that, okay? Because Johnny Versace, he doesn't get a second chance down here, right? I don't care if you made quadmillions of dollars designing clothes. If you don't have a white robe of righteousness for all of eternity, you've had the wrong clothes the entire time and do that. Okay, but yet you can talk to people right in front of his beautiful mansion right there on South Beach, right on the beach, gorgeous place, okay? But standing right there and do that. Go to Psalm 23. Psalm 23, verse 3. Okay, volunteer, Psalm 23 and verse 3. Mike?
He restoreth my soul, he leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's
sake. Hey, isn't it nice to know we got a leader? All we have to do is follow the Lord, okay? And he'll take us on the right paths, okay? Didn't we have friends take us down the wrong path, like giving us a beer in ninth grade in a car in Atlanta, Georgia? Yeah, that's the wrong path, okay? It's nice to know we have a God that will take us down the right path. And Isaiah 61, go to Isaiah 61. And go to verses 1, 2, and 3. So three volunteers. Isaiah 61, verses 1, 2, and 3. Okay? Hands up for me. Okay, verse 1, verse 2, someone for 3, verse 3. Okay?
The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners.
Okay, liberty to the captives. And that's one thing, if we're ever in any type of addiction, we want liberty, okay? And that's what the Lord provides. Verse 2.
To proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn.
Think about that. There's a day of vengeance with our God, okay? Verse 3. Isn't that beautiful? Even when I do all the crazy stuff I do, God still wants to just put his anointing of joy on me. For what? That he might be glorified. Not that Mark gets glorified, that he will get glorified in how we serve God and do that, okay? We bring glory to him when we repent of those sins and get on that narrow road, and he works through us and does that, okay? Life can get messy sometimes, can it? Yeah, and get real messy. The world's full of sinners, including us, correct? Yeah, excluding us that are full of the sinners. I was teaching school one time, and a couple of the boys came to me. Mr. Cahill, so-and-so is using LSD. Okay? I'm like, come on, fellas. And because LSD is a past drug, like a way, way past drug. No, it's not actually, okay? No, Mr. Cahill, we've heard through the grapevine, so-and-so is using LSD. Well, I care about my students, so I picked up the phone and called his mother. Okay, hey, this is what I heard from some of the students, okay? Don't know for sure, but I've actually been watching your son, okay? His grades have plummeted in the last couple months, okay? He's coming to school wearing all dark clothing, okay? Very disheveled, very just disheveled. Hair's messy and face is messy, and he wasn't like that before. I said, ma'am, if it was me and I'm looking at a situation, we got a problem, okay? He's into something. She looked at me and said, no, he's not. I said, well, how do you know that to be true? He said, I'm a drug counselor for a living. That's what she did for a living. She actually does drug counseling. I didn't know that. That's what she did. She said, I know the signs to look for. He exhibits none of the signs. Okay, a couple months later, it came out that he was doing what? LSD, yeah. And sometimes the blindest of the blind people are who? Yeah, it's the parent right there and do that. Okay, so sometimes God's trying to bring you somebody to... And remember, when those situations happen, we're not trying to point a finger at mom and dad. That's not what we're trying to do. We're just trying to say, we noticed something, okay? We're hoping we're wrong. But if we're right, we need to do something now, okay? Because there's trouble farther down that road, okay? That's why even back in the day before it became legal that you had to do it, it became the law, whenever I... got any inclination that a child was even close, remotely, might possibly be thinking about suicide, I was on the phone with a parent, okay? Because I don't want the phone call when so-and-so has done that. Sure enough, I was at the mall 1 year ago, Lenox Mall in Atlanta, and I'm witnessing to somebody. All of a sudden, this guy and this girl, they're about 10 feet from him, three people, and this... one guy, he just keeps staring at me. He just keeps staring at me. And so I finished with these people, and I walk. I said, hey, can I help you? He said, I know you. I said, I know you too. I said, what's your name? He said, so-and-so. I said, you were in that youth group that I spoke to a couple times. He said, yeah. I said, matter of fact, you emailed me one time. He said, yeah. I said, I called your mom, didn't I? He said, yes, you did. Okay. And I said, you know what? He said, well, I said, I'm so glad you're alive. This is 10 years later, right? It's 10 years later. And he said, well, I wasn't really suicidal. Okay, I don't agree with that because I took his email and sent it to somebody else. I said, if you read this and didn't know a thing about this kid, what would you think? And the other person told me, he said, these are suicidal statements. And I said, okay. So I called his mom that day. I said, mom, I said, where's your son at? He says, he's right here. I said, where's your husband at? He flies home tonight on a business trip. I said, okay, do me a favor. She said, yeah. I said, your son does not leave your eyeballs at any moment today. Okay, this is the email I've gotten, and when your husband gets home tonight, I need you and him to sit down and talk with him and see what he'll open up about, okay? And bingo, they sat down, then I opened up, and that young man is still here 10 years later and going on with his life and stuff, okay? Because we don't want, because I've had a student commit suicide before. I actually had to speak at a funeral of a student who committed suicide, and that is not what you want to do on one of your afternoons, to speak at one of those funerals. So you'd rather head it off well before that ever happens and do that, okay? So again, that's why we're reaching out and do this. So we do that with the parents as well and do that, okay? The other thing to think about is especially with sin, we'll do some Q&A in just a second, especially with sin, I always tell people, be very careful of little sin. Okay. Sometimes with our kids, we're worried about big sins. Okay. No. Don't worry about the big. Worry about the little sins. Okay. Because if your kids can lie to you where they went on Friday night and they didn't really go there, and they telling you they went one place, they went another, that's a major red flag. Okay. Because if they can lie about the little ones, then they can what? Lie about the big ones. Okay, so I'm always much more concerned with, because it says in both Matthew, it's either 1st or I think it's 2nd Corinthians and James, let your yes be yes and your no be no. It's all about keeping your word, and it's huge with God. And one of the things that hit me was back in the day, I used to work for Domino's Pizza back in the day, because I liked to eat. And so I was in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, but the headquarters is right over here. In Ann Arbor is the headquarters for Domino's and stuff. So we used to fly for meetings and stuff. But I ran this group, and we made pizza dough, okay? So we had a mixer. We made, some days we made enough for 50,000 pizza balls a day. Okay, we had a 24-hour operation rolling, okay? We could produce pizza balls. We had a 500-pound mixer. So mamas, think about your kitchen, okay? A 500-pound mixer. It was about yay wide and stood about yay tall, right about there, okay? You put 300 pounds of flour in there, okay? 175 pounds of water. Then you put it what's called a premix bag, which had salt, sugar, shortening. Put 25 pounds. So you had 500 pounds of mix, okay? Now, how much yeast would you have to put in there to get all that dough to rise in Louisiana, Mississippi? How much yeast? About 1 pound. And when the 1 pound got mixed through, okay, and we took it and we ship it to the stores, and then it's something called autolyzing. And what the yeast does, it eats the sugars, gives off the gas, and that's what makes the dough rise. Okay? As a matter of fact, the only time we would ever get in trouble is if they forgot to put the yeast in the batch. Because then you ship it out to the store, and they don't have pizza dough. What do you call it? The dough that doesn't rise. What do you call it? Yeah, it's like matzah bread. You know, it's like Jewish bread, right? There's no yeast in it, right? So it's just flat bread. It doesn't rise. Now you're in trouble because they can't sell that and do it. Then you're really in trouble and do that. But it only took 1 pound of the yeast to make all that lump go. That's all Satan wants. He just wants a hook into our life, a little sin in your life, and then the little sin begins to autolyze, and you're here. But wait. When I had the first beer or the first toke on a joint, I didn't know it was going to take me to a prison cell. 75 to 80% of the men in jail, they're for drug or alcohol reasons. Either stealing for their habit or doing something under the influence, and that's what they're there for. My aunt, she had her leg amputated from her knee down. 82 years old, has her leg amputated. She started smoking 50 years ago. All her veins closed up. She couldn't get the circulation down there, and actually she had to get her leg amputated. The day she had her leg amputated, has she smoked since then? Not at all. Not at all. Was able to give it up like that. But what she knows now, do you think she would have had that first cigarette 50 years ago? Would have never touched it. Would have never touched it if I knew I was going to lose half of one of my legs to do that. Okay, think about that for a second. Fascinating. All right, but that's what sin does. It just gets in, and then it just starts to autolyze. So we got to close that door, shut it, and lock it. Okay, so you have an open door in your life, whatever the door is. Okay, repent of it, shut it, lock it, move on with your life. Okay, but no, Satan's not going to give up. He won't give up to the day at your last breath. That's when he'll give up. Okay, and do that, but he won't do it until that day and do that. Okay. So again, it's God's truth we're always looking for, walking by faith, filled with joy, living with a purpose. That's really when you set your mind on things above, you're living with a purpose. You have a reason you're living today, right? We have an exciting reason to live. You parents raise up good, godly Christian kids in 2015 and beyond. But I always tell parents, we don't need any more Christian kids in 2015. We need warriors for Jesus Christ. We need rock-solid men and women of God that will raise up and stand up being so strong on their schools, their campuses, and their neighborhoods, on their sports teams. But every time I typically meet a powerful Christian kid for the Lord, I find out about their family. And almost always to the T, you get a mom or dad right behind them, just passionate for God, love the Lord. It just oozed down into their kids. It rippled into their kids. And now they stand up for God and Jesus Christ and do the same thing. Okay, and that's the responsibility of you. And we'll talk about that some more tomorrow night. With your past parents and do that, okay? So again, remember, even if some of you folks are older here, I don't care if your kids are 50, they're still your kids. Still your kids, okay? If you've never had a Bible study before Thanksgiving dinner, whatever, this is the year to start it, okay? They're still your kids. My dad just turned 80 about a week ago, 2 weeks ago, and my dad's not saved yet, but I still to this day go ask my dad questions. Questions about life. Why, he's farther down the road than I am. Okay, he knows things that I don't know. And I can't ask him spiritual questions because he's not there. But I can ask him those types. He'll still always be my father. I'll always be his son. No matter how old I get, I'll always be his son and do that. Okay, so remember that as the parents to do that. Okay, then I had Psalm in my notes. I actually had Psalm verses chapter 1 in my notes to go through. Okay, I didn't know you guys already had it up here. Okay, so we're thinking on the same page, because be careful who you hang with, right? Because if you're hanging with the ungodly, you're going to act ungodly and do that in your days. And then on my flight in today, I was sitting next to a lady named Queen. She's a first sergeant in the Army, and she was flying to Seoul, Korea. So she was popping back through Detroit to go to Seoul. And we were talking, very interesting conversation, probably use some of it tomorrow night as well. But one of the things she said to me was that really caught me. She said, every day in Seoul, they give her a radio. And every day in the radio, you type in frequencies, okay? So you can talk with certain people in certain places on the base, or when you're practicing, your military drills. Because she said the last thing you ever do in the military is to practice wartime stuff during a war. You practice wartime stuff during peace. Because when it's war, you got to go to war, right? So you have to be prepared for what's coming up ahead. So it was very interesting just being prepared ahead. But she said every day they give you a radio, but it's been someone else's radio. So the very first thing you do with the radio you get every day, it says you clear it out. You clear all the frequencies out that were in there from the day before, because they're not your frequencies. Then you type in your frequencies and do that. Okay? And she called it midnight, a midnight clear. She loved to get to midnight. Because when she got to midnight, she would take the radio and clear the radio. It's just clear. The slate is clean and gone. I've got a new radio now. I just have to type in the frequencies, and I can go from there and do that. Very interesting to think about. Isn't it nice to know when we come to Christ, we get a new life? Isn't it nice to know that he clears the slate out, right, and it's all gone? And he can type in new frequencies on what Mark's supposed to be doing with his life now, what I was doing before. But we do mess up along the journey, don't we? Yes, we do. And there's sometimes we just need to repent of it, clear the radio back out, right? Just clear it out, and you get that fresh start again. Aren't you glad for fresh starts? I'm so glad for fresh starts, okay? So that's one of the other things to always remember, is if you're dealing with one of these issues areas and you slip up back into it again, don't beat yourself up. Don't beat yourself up. Repent of it, clear it back out again, fresh slate in Christ, and then back on down the road again. Does that make sense? Yeah, sometimes we just don't, okay, he's forgiven me twice for it. I know he can't forgive me a third time. Nope, we don't understand the true battle going on around us with Satan and the angels and the Holy Spirit and the devil. We don't understand. We're not going to get it to the other side. Okay, so the battle's always going to be there. It's always going to continue, especially the closer you walk to Christ and the cross, because fewer people have been there. It doesn't list like 2,000 people in the Bible that walked with God. Okay, we have Enoch, and I believe there's one other one that actually uses the term walked with God. I can't, who is Moses? Noah. Oh, it was Noah, that's right. Okay, walked with God. You're not getting that from a bunch of different characters in the Bible, okay? It's a rare breed that walks with God and does that, okay? But who wouldn't, isn't that the one Satan you'd want to take out? Because then the ripple effect, Satan would just ripple down into other people's lives and do that, okay? All right, let's do a little question and answer before we close up. So what are questions we've got maybe about addictions or struggles for you, or maybe something you're dealing with one of your kids, or how to help somebody in a certain area? Or again, I always speak on sharing your faith and stuff like that. If you got a question on witnessing to a certain type of person or something like that, let me try to help you there. So pop some hands up and ask me. Yes, ma'am.
How could you help somebody that has anger or unforgiveness, and then for a passage of time they're not able to deal with it, and then it's like they start with a whole different scenario, like a lie that they live, that the truth, they can't recognize the truth. Like, say they were here tonight and they saw this. It overpowers them that they would deny that.
Okay, a couple things. One, if you're dealing with somebody with anger issues, there's an event that causes the anger to come out. Okay, this is, you just have to know that, okay? There is some event going on that is, and it doesn't even mean it can be something from eons ago, and they're expressing it out in a certain way to you that's getting it, okay, and doing that. So again, whenever I'm dealing with somebody, student, whatever, with anger issues, I'm always trying to dig deeper to find out what the issue was, okay? For instance, I'm on, in the story's in one of my books, I was on a plane flight going to Phoenix. I have a Jewish guy next to me, Ari. He was 20 or 21, and I told the story at Beast Feast a few years ago, and Ari, his dad divorced his mom when he was in ninth grade, okay? And he looked at me, and he said, "Sir, my father did not come to one of my high school football games, not one," okay? He looked at me, he said, "My father didn't even come to my high school graduation." Oh, this kid was mad. He was angry. He said, "Sir," he said, "I'm bulimic." Oh, isn't that interesting? So we think bulimia is just a lady issue. It's not just a lady issue, okay? And this anger was driving this kid crazy. It was eating him up, okay, that he couldn't even hold food down. He said, "I just started being able to eat. It was just a few weeks ago." And he was a big, strong kid, too, played high school football and stuff. I said, "Ari, if you don't forgive your father for what he did, Ari, you can never, ever be the man God wants you to be. It's an impossibility. Even if you're a Christian harboring anger, you can't be the man or woman God wants you to be. There's no way. It's going to hold you back." And so I just use a simple example with people. I said, "Ari, if you and I ran a 100-meter dash, okay, who do you think would win?" He said, "I would probably beat you." I said, "You're correct." I said, "You would beat me." I said, "Ari, if I took a ball and a chain," and you've seen in the old, you know, the old movies, prison movies, where they put the ball and chain on someone's foot, "and I put a ball and chain on your foot, Ari, and you and I ran a 100-meter dash," I said, "who do you think would win?" He hesitated, and it hurt my feelings that he actually hesitated, thinking he could beat me with a ball and chain on. I'll never forget this. Like, man, he was just going right for my heart. It hurt. And he said, "I think you would win." I said, "Ari, I could walk and beat you in a 100-meter dash. You'll be so tired from carrying that ball and chain by the 50-meter mark. I can walk and beat you, Ari." I said, "Ari, that's what unforgiveness does. If you cannot forgive those people, you are carrying a ball and chain around you, trying to go through life, okay, finishing the race for Christ, and you can't finish the race well for Christ with the ball and chain, okay? So if you have something that needs to be forgiven, forgive that person. I don't care what it is. Remember, though, it doesn't matter what their response is. You just have to do the biblical thing and do the forgiving, okay? If they receive it or not receive it, it's not your issue, okay? I had an issue with one of my old principals, went back to Columbus, Georgia, apologized for something I did, and I expected something great coming back. Didn't get it, okay? Didn't bother me. I had to get it off my chest, release it so I could get on with my life and do what God wanted me to do, and it hasn't held me back since then to do that, okay? And then always when someone's dealing with lies, give them what? Truth. Spoken in love. Ephesians 4, and do that, okay? So when someone tells you there's many different paths to heaven, no, there's what? One path to heaven. I give them the truth to trump the lie and do that. So Satan gives lies. We take, again, don't play cards. But if you ever played cards back in the day, you played cards. And because can cards be addicting? Oh, of course they can be addicting, okay? But when you used to play cards back in the day, wasn't it nice to know when you had that trump card? Okay, but not the trump card. Which one? The ace, right? Whatever the suit was. Because you could hold that in your hand. You could hold it all day. You got the little grin thing going on, right? Because you know, at any point you want to, you can pull that trump out and you win the trick. Hey, we have the trump card. It's stamped in the blood of Jesus Christ. We can trump anything on the table that Satan throws out there, okay, in the blood of Christ and do that. So I got to know what the truth is. I always drop the truth over a lie and it covers a lie and do that, okay? Good, okay. Hands up. What are questions you got on dealing with these issues or any other topic there? Okay, so one of the things you want to do is light is supposed to shine in what? Darkness, okay? So actually, it's a very easy time to share our faith in America because there's a lot of what? It's dark everywhere, man. It's just getting interesting out here. It seems dark, dark, dark. So what you want to do is remember, you want to share your faith where you spend most of your time at, okay? So was I witnessing on the trains getting me to the Atlanta airport today, yes or no? Yes. Was I witnessing in the Atlanta airport today, yes or no? Yes. Was I witnessing the Queen on the plane flight today, yes or no? Yes, okay, because that's where I spend my time at, okay? Students, the place, number one place you should be witnessing and sharing your faith at is where? School is where you spend your time at. You talk with other students, you talk with the teachers and things like that. For most of us men, where do we spend most of our time at? It's at work, okay? Now we have the thing of also, though, but they didn't hire me to share my faith. They hired me to do my job. Okay, so one of the things I always tell anybody in the workforce is remember, when you're doing your job, one of the most important things to always remember is make sure you're the best employee in that company. Okay? And the reason I say that is because I've been a boss and I know bosses. Bosses will never get rid of one person. Who's the person they will not get rid of? The best employee in the company. Okay? So for instance, I spoke in Canada. I did a big Korean event up there, and this one Korean guy really liked me. Nice guy, and he worked in the oil business. And he would witness to all his customers, okay? And he would just ask them, hey, what'd you do this weekend? And they say, oh, do this. Because then they come back with a question. What'd you do this weekend? Oh, on Saturday, this is my family. Sunday, I went to church with my family. Hey, by the way, do you do church stuff? Do you do anything like that? And then bingo, they would just start talking spiritual stuff, okay? One customer complained to his boss. Boss pulled him in. Said, hey, I've got a complaint about you. I need you to stop talking about your faith, Jesus Christ, with customers, stuff like that. He said, well, he said, I can't give you that guarantee. He said, why? He said, because I'm a Christian. He said, everywhere I go, Jesus goes with me. I don't leave him at the front door of a gas station. I don't leave him at the front door of my house when I walk out. I don't leave him at the front door when I come to work. I mean, I'm a Christian everywhere I go. We're not light switch Christians where we flit on and off at times. You're either a Christian or you're not a Christian, okay? You can't turn it off and on. We want to. The world wants us to turn it off. He said, I can't do that. Well, guess what? He was the number two salesman in the entire company. Did the boss get rid of him, yes or no? Of course he didn't get rid of him, okay, because he was such a good employee. So a couple things. One, make sure that you're, one, a great employee. Two, our attitudes really do matter when we're out, especially in the workplace, okay? Christians should be great to work with, right? We should be great. We should be encouraging other workers. We should be encouraging our bosses. And when you're an encourager like that, who doesn't want an encourager around? We don't want the people draining us around. We want the encouragers in our lives. So that's one, two, doing our job well. Three, remember, when it's work time, it's work time. We need to be the best employee in that place, okay? But during those 15-minute breaks when I'm sitting there drinking coffee at my desk or whatever, read your Bible, read one of your books, one of the books. Like, for instance, I know a guy, he leaves the book I wrote, One Heartbeat Away. He just leaves a couple copies on the corner of his desk. And he'll read his Bible during his coffee. People walk by. Hey, what are you reading? I'm reading the Bible. What's that book? Hey, I met this guy. He wrote this. I said, well, what's it about? He said, it's about life and death, man. What happens if you die? It's very, you know, something we all got to think about. You know, so-and-so, we got to think about that. Hey, do you like to read? Yeah, I do. I said, okay, you can have a copy. You just got to read it. Let me know what you think. He has books literally going through his workplace because they're all coming off the corner of his desk because people are taking them off his desk. See, then they can never get you for shoving or pushing your faith on someone to do that because they're actually asking the questions. Take people to lunch, okay? Take your lost coworkers to lunch, okay? I always tell students, help the atheists in the class study for the exam. The Muslim kid's not doing that. The agnostic kid's not doing it. The Christian kid. Why would the Christian kid take me to help me, and then he tells me about Christ? Why isn't no one else trying to reach out to me? So you're always looking for opportunities like that and do that. When you're driving to and from places, do that. But you travel, so just make sure hotels, restaurants. I just had a great talk with Adam, my waiter, a second ago. Rob, the guy in the food runner there, because he had some tattoos on. Hey, what are your tattoos for? And this was something. Then he had three triangles all intercircled together. Hey, what's that for? Well, that's three of my buddies. And we're just real close friends. And we got them all intertwined together and stuff like that because we're going to stay good buddies all of our lives. I said, so did it happen? He's only 21. He said, no, actually one of them's already walked out of the group a little bit. And it always happens. Do that. I said, really, what happened? Boom, boom, boom. I said, you know the number one reason people will walk out from being buddy-buddy? He said, no, what? I said, think about it. And of course, when three guys decide we're going to be the best of friends, what's the one thing that gets in between those three guys is almost always, 99% of the time, what? A girl. That's right, a girl. And she comes in. All of a sudden, the boy gets pulled away. All of a sudden, now they're not close friends. Then typically, 99.9% of the time, the girl and the guy end up doing what? Oh, not getting married. No, no, no. They'll go through 15, 20 before they get there. They'll end up breaking up. Then they'll want to come back to the group, and the guys have already moved on. And they actually get a double hurt. The girl walking with them, their buddies have gone too. I've actually had too many boys tell me that's what's happened to them. So it's interesting how Satan always works it. So again, I just know walking into a place, I am going to share my faith in doing that. I just got to make sure that it's done in such a loving, caring way that people know that I'm doing. So sometimes it's in the office, sometimes it's out the office. But if you're a business owner, a good website for you is christianlaw.com, christianlaw.com. Or christianlaw.org, one of the two. But they actually list on there. You can get little pamphlets. But if you're a business owner, do you know you can put scripture verses on your checks? You can have type on every check you give to every employee, you can have a scripture verse on if you're the owner of the company. You can do so much as a business owner and do that. Well, you were telling me about, you know, the cardiologist that gives my books away to his patients and different people and stuff. So again, like I'm going to go to a mall witnessing tomorrow. Again, when it comes to witnessing in a workplace, you don't want to ask permission first. You just do it. Okay, then if anything pops up, you deal with it afterwards. Sometimes we ask permission first, okay? And a lot of employers don't even know what the laws are. We deal with that on the streets in Atlanta. A lot of police don't know what the laws are. They just want you out of the way, okay, because it's something different. But when you're out there enough, like there's a, what's your arena here where the Pistons play at? What's it called? Oh, it's here. It's Rochester Hills, right? No, it's Auburn Hills. That's what it is, okay. The Palace, that's right. Well, the one in Atlanta is called Phillips Arena, and there's a street right in front of it, like a public sidewalk. So we stand on the public sidewalk and hand tracks out, talk to people and stuff. All the concerts are there and all the other stuff. So it's a great place to reach people and stuff. And I have been sick, and I've been traveling a lot, and I come out the other day. Policeman walks up to me. Hey, Mark, where have you been? I haven't seen you in a while. Where have you been? Okay, now, we're out there enough that Micah knows Mark, okay, and Micah wanted to know where I had been and stuff. I said, how's your daughter? He just had a baby. He pulls his phone out. He's showing me pictures. Of. See, we've built a good relationship with the police out there, so now it's gotten to the point they want to know when you're not there, where have you been? Why haven't you been on the streets reaching people for Jesus Christ and stuff, okay? So again, so we want to build it up that that they're expecting us to be strong and stand strong for God and Jesus Christ. That's just the expectation for believers to do that, okay? All right, any other questions? Before we close up, okay, when you walk out, there's a table back there. I got two things on the table. There's a DVD called Lukewarm No More. It's a talk I give. I don't give it much anymore, but I get more emails, people watching this Lukewarm No More, that they watch the talk I give, and they just, have you read Revelation 3, you know, lukewarm? Does God have an opinion on lukewarm, yes or no? It's a pretty strong one, isn't it? Yeah, he's not quite playing. We play with lukewarm. He doesn't play with lukewarm, okay? I will spit you. I will vomit you. I will spew you out of my mouth. And the word actually means a violent reaction. And I say it on the DVD. I said, can the life of a Christian cause the God of the universe to be sick to his stomach? That's an interesting thing to think about. Okay, so as you walk out, there's those DVDs. And then I had a new book come out. It's called Reunion. It came out last summer. And it's actually a novel, but it's all true. It's what you call historical fiction or realistic fiction. And in the book, I took four seniors through their senior year of high school. So I took them through football season, spring break, all the fun stuff and all that crazy stuff. But the end of their senior year, they make a commitment to come back to every high school reunion. So that's the title. So they come back 10th, 20th, 30th. And of course, us who are getting older, isn't that true? All of our lives are in these crazy, you have friends doing jobs like, what are you doing that job? You would have never expected, right? But they're dealing with a lot of big issues. One guy goes to prison for a while. He got involved in a bunch of stuff. And well, what's going to happen with him? So it's crazy. But the last chapter is called the 1,000th reunion. Because that's the question. do we get together on the other side, or are we just friends down here? But do we get together on the other side? Oh, yes, we do. Okay, but it depends on who's right with who? Jesus Christ, if we're going to be in the right destination, okay? Well, what happens is one of their friends is a Christian guy. He's actually a homeschooler. So you know homeschoolers is a great book for them. They like him so much they invite him to every high school reunion, okay? So at every reunion, they start popping questions at him, okay? Okay, all right, Jeremiah, is there a God? Tell us that, okay? Boom, they start talking about it. One of the girls in the book goes into an alternate lifestyle. Jeremiah, you know she's wrong. Give us some verses, okay? So they keep popping him to come in. So this Christian guy keeps popping truth, trumping all the lies that are being told to these people. One of the guy becomes a Muslim. So this is a great book for Muslims to give, okay? Matter of fact, a friend of mine in New Haven, she knows the exact page where the Muslim conversation starts. So when she's talking to a Muslim, oh, come here, page 167, come here, okay, start right here, okay, and then she'll give the book to a Muslim guy to start right there because it shows you how I witnessed to, because that's what it is, it's basically how I witnessed to somebody, a Muslim, to give them truth on the real Jesus because they believe in Jesus, right, Isa, I-S-A, Isa, but is it the same Jesus we believe in? No, because if you go to Jerusalem and you look inside, what's the name of the mosque there? Dome of the Rock, etched on the wall, like you have these nice banners, etched on the wall, inside the Dome of the Rock, on the side of the, inside the Dome of the Rock, what's etched on the inside? Allah had no son. A direct mockery of the Lord Jesus Christ inside the Dome of the Rock right there in Jerusalem. Okay, they don't even play. Muslims aren't even playing with this. Your Jesus doesn't exist, okay? Doesn't even exist. See, this is all, it's all coming down to Jesus one more time, okay? Who's the real Jesus, okay? And that's what it's coming down to. Reunion, I just had a guy email me yesterday, 70-year-old man. He just emailed me. He got to the end of the book, and he started crying. And he's a really neat guy, friend of mine. And he got there because you don't know who's going to get saved and who's not going to get saved. And when he got to the end, he couldn't believe somebody had gotten saved at the end of the book. But wait, shouldn't we feel that way when one of our friends repents of their sins and gets born again and say we should be so pumped and excited about that and do that, okay? Jesus said it's more blessed to give than receive, so that table is for you back there, so there's no charge for anything on the table, so the books and the DVDs, so everything should be clear and off the table, okay? So you take a DVD, take a book, whatever you want off there, no charge for that. I always tell people, especially young people, to be a leader, you gotta be a reader. Right? To be a leader, you got to be a reader. So soak your mind with good stuff and do that. All right? And so those are back there for you. All right? And Paul said, I'll use this tomorrow night, but Paul said to Timothy, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course of the race. And I have kept the faith. Okay? One last thing. Everybody in this room, finish well. Finish well. Okay? What? Yeah, finish the race. Finish the course well, okay? And if you're running the race and you drop the baton, do what? Reach down, pick it up, and keep going again, okay? We don't need the world record. We don't need the gold medal. That's not what you're trying to get when you meet Jesus. Just finish the race, the course well. That's all he's looking for. So make sure this is a group that finishes well. And then we hand the baton correctly behind us to those ones coming from behind us and do that. Okay, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for just a really nice time. What a fun time this was. So I thank you for all the people that came out tonight. Hopefully there's some good biblical truth that they can grab a hold of, maybe a little nugget here or there. Father God, let them enjoy the books and the DVDs. And so, Father, I thank you for temptation. That sounds weird, but the Bible says to be thankful in all circumstances. So if Satan's tempting us, that's actually a good thing. He's trying to pull us off track, so that means he's kind of worried about us in some sense of the word. But it also says that you always provide us a way of an escape when the temptations come. So, Father, anybody is walking a temptation road, that, Father, give them that way of escape. Let them jump on that little narrow road, get into that way of escape, and then get out of it. And just remind us of that, Father, that we need to have some doors shut and locked in our lives that will finish well. So, Father God, remind us your grace and mercy is beautiful, that we get to clear the radio all the time with your blood and do that, repent and back on the road, and And just thank you for the lives you've changed in here, and through these people you're going to change in the days to come. You're just so gracious, so kind, and so merciful, and we just thank you so much for that, and we do. We ask it in the great name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Amen.